awesome God. His goodness is great, and his mercy is kind. We thank God tonight for all of you that have come. Last night, my God, they had folk, you know, people whisper, who is he? Nobody don't know him. The Lord know him. You know him after last night, too. God has preachers that we have never heard. And that's why I try and bring a diversity of ministers. I have some for him now. I got some for him. I bring a diversity of ministers to this Christian Ministers Union of New Orleans and vicinity. I'm grateful to so many for so much, because all we do is evangelize. Reverend Henderson, would you come up and join with us? Some of you sitting way at the back. I don't like preachers sitting at the back of the church. It bothers me, and preachers. I had to get Bishop up here. I'm certainly glad to have Bishop with us tonight. Amen. Bishop J.D. Wiley, amen. Amen. Glad to have my president-elect Fred T. Porter of United Baptist Association. Our past president and state convention president, Dr. C.S. Gordon, was with us last night. Dr. Turner was with us last night, and Dr. Willie Montgomery of Rising Sun, come on up, Reverend, Rising Sun is with us again tonight. And I'm certainly great to have all these preachers here. We know Reverend James McGee is part of Christian Ministers Union of New Orleans and vicinity. I just like to have the pulpit, you know. See, I'm sorry, J.D., I'm from the old school, you know. I can't get with this one chair in the pulpit, but I can't get with it. Right. These young fellas, you know, that's the way they do it. They said, I can't get with that. They tell me, you still sitting behind the pulpit. We sit on the other way. That's good for y'all. A few more years, you'll be able to do this and that. But as long as I'm here, we're going to do it this way. I'm excited tonight. Come on. I want all of our street workers to stand. All of our Christian Ministers Union people to stand. Amen. We call these our foot soldiers. You may be seated. We call these our foot soldiers. Sister Betty Jackson gives leadership to our sisterhood. An extremely kind, courageous, energetic, sympathetic Christian woman. A godly woman. You need to understand the significance of a godly woman. And you study the Bible, you know what I'm talking about. And so we are grateful to have people that labor in love. Teach women how to be women. Young women, you can learn a lot following Sister Jackson and a lot of those, Sister Robinson, and all of our warriors in the Lord. And our child evangelist specialist, Sister Bertha, 80 plus. And still witnessing. Got married a couple of years ago, too. And they tell me that keeps you looking young. That's a blessing from the Lord. Yeah, don't get so holy that you don't know how to enjoy life. Praise the Lord. God created man, and then he created woman. He gave man dominion. Amen? And I don't know no woman that don't mind following a godly man. Being submissive to a godly man. Tonight, I'm not going to introduce our preacher. He introduced himself last night. But I just want to give leadership to the Christian Ministers Union. Thank these pastors who took time out of their busy schedule. Pastor Moore from St. Thomas Baptist Church. Pastor Henderson from Mount Sinai. Is that, isn't that right? All right. Mount Sinai. And, of course, our young preacher, Dr. Rufus Bond. Been pastoring one church almost 50 years. 80-plus years, still going strong. Taught me biblical theology to know what to do with it. Amen? And Reverend Bernard Murray, the treasurer for United Baptist Association, he's here with us. That's my longtime friend. Come on up, Dean McDowell. Come on, that's the dean of our seminary. Want him to come up and be with us tonight, because we have a host of ministers that support Christian Ministers Union. That's why this is our 44th year. If you can keep preachers together for 44 years, Jetty.
Come on.
Now, I call it that affection because we close like that. I don't mean no disrespect, but Jetty and I are close. And, you know, a lot of folk may not know that, you know. But you start something, you'll find out. So tonight, Dr. Reginald G. Reid, who labored last night in the Word. If you pray for him, he'll bless you tonight again. One lady said she went, one of my members told me, Rev, I went to sleep hearing him, and I woke up hearing him. That's a blessing from God. Reid is not an entertainer. He's a preacher. And it's obvious he spends time with God. When you stand here, you can tell whether the man is playing or, you know. If you're playing, you're in the wrong place. Christian Ministers Union, you know. No. We thank God for it. Good to see Dr. Dawson tonight. Bless you, man. All right. I didn't miss any. There's no other preacher hiding at the back, huh? Because sometimes my eyesight. No, I saw Reverend Green. He's holding his baby. He didn't want to come sit with us. Bless him. Strong supporter from Second Baptist Church and down in the cutoff. His grandfather and I were real close. I used to preach at Second Baptist when Reverend Green was still running the other direction. He was coming to church, but he wasn't thinking about no preaching. God has a way, doesn't he? So tonight, what we're going to do tonight. Let me check with my musician. Have y'all finished y'all singing, or y'all want to do one more selection? One more selection. Then our special guest, who is a member of the Mount Kingdom Missionary Baptist Church. Tell somebody on Louisa Street. Praise the Lord. Sister Karen Hintz is going to bless our hearts tonight. After they sing a selection, Sister Hintz, and then Pastor Reid from Texarkana, Texas. Let us praise the Lord. Amen.
gonna bless the Lord in here tonight. Have you any rivers that you think are uncrossable? And have you any mountains that you can't tunnel through? God specializes, in so many things that seem impossible, but he will do what no other power, no other power can do. Have you ever been on your bed of affliction and the doctor's done all he could do? I stopped by to tell you that God, he specializes, in healing all kinds of diseases, and he will do what no other power, doctor or lawyer, can do. God, he specializes. So many things. Anybody ever been sick? So many things. In so many things that seem impossible. But he will do what no other power, the power can do. Y'all sitting out there looking at me like I got something on my face. Maybe the Lord has never done anything for you. Maybe he's never gotten a child out of jail. Maybe he's never helped you to pay that car note that you didn't know where the money was coming from. God, he specializes. Oh, in so many things that seem impossible. And do what no other power, doctor or lawyer, can. They can do. Choir, will you help me? I know God specializes. God, ooh, he specializes. When you're sick,
People of God said amen. If you love God with all of your heart, give him a hand clap of praise tonight. To the honored and esteemed pastor and moderator, Dr. Sam J. Johnson, and to those who make up this movement, to all of you, our father's children, to the preachers and pastors who are here, I've got another day's journey, and I'm glad about it. If you don't mind, tonight, it's Wednesday night, and I'd like to echo the words of Courtney Mitchell on last night. I'm so glad that I'm on top of the dirt instead of the dirt being on top of me. Are you glad about that tonight? Oh, let me ask you again, are you glad about that tonight? I got enough sense to know that it could have gone the other way. But because of God's grace and his mercy. As a matter of fact, Lamentations suggests to us that he opens a package of mercy every morning. Brand new mercy every single morning. And you ought to be glad about that. I failed to do it last night because when I got up, I guess I was like I was on my first sermon. I was just as afraid as a goat is a butcher knife. I failed to mention the music ministry and those soloists and the choir. You've got some awesome talents and gifted people here in this area. Come on, give it up for the musicians and for the choir and soloists. And let me say again, as I have said privately, thank you so much, Pastor Johnson, for allowing me to come and to share these 3 nights. Last night, I did the best that I could to try to share a relevant word from the Lord. I trust and hope that something was said that will help aid and benefit you in your everyday life. And let me say, I'm thanking God. I'm almost seriously shaking in my shoes. The late Dr. B.C. Green says that when you get so many doctors around, you know, somebody ought to be helped somewhere along the line. And I would have been all right tonight had Pastor Johnson not said who they were and the titles that they held. I'd have been all right tonight. But be that as it may, let me say again tonight, I've not come to play, but I've come for kingdom business. I'm not an entertainer at all, but I want to give you what God has laid on my heart to give to you. And those of you who have your Bibles tonight, turn with me to an Old Testament passage of Scripture, 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 30. First Samuel chapter 30. And before I read, I want to go to God in prayer and ask God's blessing upon us as we share in his word. Let's pray. God, here we are again tonight. You've allowed us to come and to worship you again in another worship experience. God, the only reason that we've come tonight is to hear what you have to say. Thank you for another preaching privilege. Thank you for that chance, God, that you've given unto me to stand before your people. God, I don't take it lightly, but I want to thank you for using me in spite of me. I also pray tonight, God, that you would give me an extra dose of your anointing tonight that will make preaching easy in this place. Help these your people to not only receive your word, but to respond to what they know is true. Remove every hindering spirit, every negative circumstance, even every negative facial expression. Remove everything tonight that would hinder your word from going forth. Give me the boldness to say what needs to be said and hush my mouth to those things that I ought not say. Simply put, tonight, God, have your own way. Thank you in advance for what you're going to do in this place tonight. This is what we ask in the only name that matters, the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 30. I want to begin reading at verse 21. I'm reading tonight out of the NIV translation. If you have it, would you say amen? Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 21. This is what it says. Then David came to the 200 men who had been too exhausted to follow him and who were left behind at the Bazar ravine. They came out to meet David and the people with him. As David and his men approached, he greeted them. But all of the evil men and troublemakers among David's followers said, Because they did not go out with us, we will not share with them the plunder we recovered. However, each man may take his wife and children and go. David replied, "No, my brothers, you must not do that with what the Lord has given us. He has protected us and handed over to us the forces that came against us. Who will listen to what you say? The share of the man who stayed with the supplies is to be the same as that of him who went down to the battle. All will share alike." I want to tag the text tonight by using this thought. When I'm blessed, I won't treat you like you treated me. When I'm blessed, I won't treat you like you treated me. Again tonight, brothers and sisters, I hope you've taken your amen pills. I want to talk to some real people in here tonight. Those who are not ashamed. I want you to answer a question at the risk of being embarrassed and even exposure. Have you ever been at a moment in your life where you really wanted to get back at somebody who did you wrong? I really thought that I would get more folk who would be real tonight. I'll ask one more again, if you will. Have you ever experienced a moment in your life where you wanted to get back at somebody who did you wrong? The truth of the matter is, some of us, we burned the midnight oil, plotting and planning. We were up because we couldn't rest, because we kept thinking about how we were done and how they did us, and that root of bitterness sprung up on the inside of us. And then we began to start saying things. I'm going to get you if it's the. If it's the last thing I do. And I've come tonight to suggest that it doesn't matter tonight how long you've been in church. It doesn't matter at all tonight. Whether you're in the pew walk easy Reed tonight gotta behave tonight, or in the pulpit on musical instruments, or even in the choir, there are times when that old you. Come on, help me tonight. I know you're a new creature, but let's go back down memory lane just for a minute. That there are times when that old you will really want to come out of you. H.B. Charles tells the story oftentimes that someone asks Dr. D.L. Moody, says, "Dr. Moody, are you filled with the Spirit?" And he says, "Yes, but sometimes I leak."
And I said that to say this. It doesn't matter whether you preach, whether you teach, whether you sing, whether you play, whether you pray or even praise. Every now and then that something gets over you and you really want to do something to somebody. Y'all don't make me feel like I'm by myself tonight. This text is a very interesting text tonight. But in order for me to really get to where I really want to be, come go with me back to the beginning of chapter 29. The beginning of chapter 29. I want to tell you the story, get to where I'm going to be, and then I want to sit down and tell you good night. At the beginning of chapter 29, you will discover that a war is about to take place. A war between Israel and the Philistines. The picture is kind of painted as if Israel is coming from the left side and the Philistines are coming from the right side. Behind the Philistines is a man named Achish. Behind Achish is a man named David. And behind David are 600 other men. A war is about to take place. One of the Philistine rulers happens to look over his shoulder and he asks Achish, "Who are these men following behind us?" Achish says, "That's David and 600 other men. He's only here to show and share with me that he's loyal, he's dependable, he's dedicated, and he's devoted to me. He's really here to help me. He ain't meaning any harm, but he's here to help me." The Philistine looks back and says, "Wait a minute. Is this that same David that used to be on the same side of the folk we going to fight? That they used to sing about, Saul has killed his thousands, but David has killed his 10,000. Is this that same David?" "Yeah, it's that same David." "Well, wait a minute. We're in a bad spot here. David may catch amnesia and forget whose side he's really on. And that'll be a good time for him to turn." Come on, help me tonight. "Him to turn against us." And I think that there are people in this building who are feeling just like this Philistine. Who feel like you're between a rock and a hard place. You just left trouble and you know that tomorrow you're going to face some more trouble and you really don't know what to do. This Philistine tells Achish, "You've got to send David back to the house." Watch this. David is not being rejected because of something that he's done wrong. He's not even being rejected or sent away because he's done anything to Achish. He's not even being sent away because he's done anything to the Philistine leaders. David is being sent away not for doing wrong, but for doing right. Wait a minute. He's being sent away because the person that he's connected to has somebody else that doesn't like him. Don't make this hard. If you can't help me, I'm going to have to help myself. I want to submit unto you tonight that there are some people that don't know you. They just heard about you and they don't even like you. I think I'm talking to some people in here tonight. You got some folk on your job. They don't even speak to you and they don't even know you, but you wave. They don't even wave back. They just heard about you. Have I got any help in this house? You speak to them same folk later on and then just, you know, they just eat you up. And you say, what's wrong with you? And then they come up with some stuff. I just woke up on the wrong side of the bed. Can I say something to you tonight? If you are able to get up out of the bed on any side at all, you ought to be thankful. I'm in New Orleans. I might as well drop this on you. If you got a bed, I'm sorry. If you have a bed to get up out of at all, you ought to be thankful. Why don't you give somebody a high five? Tell them I'm thankful. I may not be sleeping on what you're sleeping on, but I'm thankful that I'm sleeping on something. So now David has to go all the way back to the house. Between chapters 29 and 30 is a 3-day journey. Can you imagine having to go back because you were rejected? Not because of wrongdoing, but all because you were just trying to prove yourself. All because you just wanted to help somebody. Sent back because somebody you connected with, they're connected with somebody else that doesn't like you. And I need to tell you, sometimes folk will dislike you all because of what you look like. I'm trying to go somewhere, but you're going to have to help me get there. Sometimes folk will dislike you all because they what you look like. Chapter 30 opens up. The Amalekites have invaded Ziklag. Everything that David has ever worked for so hard for is gone. Both of his wives are gone. All of his children are gone. Everything gone up in smoke. They've been taken into captivity, if you will. And the Bible says that they cried or they wept until they had no more power to weep. Have you ever been there? I mean, for real, y'all. I really want to talk to some real folk. I know. I want to talk to folk who baptized their pillow with midnight tears. I want to talk to people who cried themselves to sleep and then who got up the next morning. You thought that the crying was over, but all of a sudden you looked at what had taken place and you start, am I talking to anybody here? Yeah, all of a sudden you begin to cry all over again. Wait a minute.
Come on now.
Then, to make matters worse, the 600 men who were with him, they began to turn their back on him. And their school of thought was this: if we were not out there trying to prove a point to Achish for you, we would have been here to protect our own stuff. Sometimes people will stick with you until things start going bad for them. And then all of a sudden, you know, they'll stick with it until mad day come. Come on, help me in this house. And when mad day come, even if it's not your fault, it is your fault. And now David has no one around. No one around to console him. He can't connect with either one of his wives because they're gone. He can't look at the children playing and perhaps get some kind of joy from them because they're gone. He can't hook up with his homies because those 600, they want to jump on him and kill him. Even when you think no one else is around, God is still there. And the Bible says that David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And I need to tell somebody, when you can't find your pastor, when you can't find your prayer partner, when you can't find mama and daddy, you ought to have a line of communication with God where you talk to him for yourself. Touch somebody, tell him, encourage yourself. Come on, touch him and shake him and tell him, encourage yourself. He encouraged himself. He says, bring me the ephod. Listen, brothers and sisters, he calls for the high priest to bring him the ephod. Listen, he literally goes around the high priest. Bring me the ephod. You going around the preacher? Didn't nobody up here say nothing. Watch this. There ought to be a time in your own life where you're going to have to establish your own connection with God, because sometimes you ain't going to be able to find the preacher. You got to call God for yourself. Have I got any help in this house? Look what David does. He doesn't go through any long, lengthy prayer. Now, it may not happen in Louisiana, but in Texas, folk get out, you know, them rhythmic and rhyming prayer. Now, Lord, here we are. One more time. Knee bent. Body bowed. Oh, I thank you that the bed that I laid down in last night, ain't nobody gonna help me in this house, was not my cooling board, and the sheet was not my winding sheet. Come on, help me in this house tonight. And I believe that I'm talking to at least 40 people in here tonight. There's some situations that have come up in your life. You ain't had time to tell God where you were or what was going on. You just said, Lord, have mercy. Here. I think I got at least 10 more folks. You say you didn't even have time to say, Lord, have mercy. You just called his name. You just said, oh, Jesus. And when you say, oh, Jesus, he'll show up. David doesn't waste any time. David just simply asked God a couple questions. He says, hey, God, should I go after my stuff? And then he says, will I recover all? None of that stuff, here I am, you know what's going on, and you know I. Should I go after my stuff? And will I recover all? And look at what the Lord said. Yes. I like that. Pursue. Go for it. Go on, man. Go get your stuff. I don't know who I'm talking to. And Doc, I just got it. I know why you call me to New Orleans. I come to tell somebody tonight that whatever the enemy has taken from you, the Lord say you go get it back. You ain't got to wait. Come on, help me in this house. I wish I had at least 5 people who really say, I'm tired of sacrificing. I'm tired of giving up stuff. I want it all back. Touch somebody, tell them I want it all back. Matter of fact, just touch 3 people, tell them I want it all back. I want it all, I want it all, I want it all. I want my family back. I want my house back. I want my car back. I want my health back. I want my sleep back. I want it all.
I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. Give it. Give it back. 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 I want it all back. Okay, 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 okay. Have you ever let anybody borrow some money? They call you on Thursday night about 9 p.m. And they say, hey, you know, dog, listen, bro, listen, sis, I'm a little short on my rent. Payday is tomorrow. I'm going to hook you up tomorrow at 3 o'clock when I get paid. Cash my check. I got you. I'm just a little short. So well, how much is your rent? $600. Okay, you're just a little short. How much do you need? I need 5. You're a little short, huh? You break out 5 crisp, big head 100. I mean 5 crisp $100 bills. And you give it to them and Friday at 3 o'clock. Is my phone on? Come on. Now, you don't hear from them. But a year later, they come with $50.
And then that root that old you, I wish y'all help me. I'm trying to wrap it up, get to where I really want to be. That old you begins to come out. And you start, you don't say it. Well, some of us don't say it, but we start thinking it. You never get your money back like that. And some of us, you know how you grabbed that person, how you went off at the mouth. I mean, your hot mouth. I mean, you went slap off. That's how sassy you got to get with the devil. Listen, you took all of my stuff. I want it all, and I want all of it right now. Don't be nickel and diming me. Don't be giving me a piece here and a piece there. You took all, y'all ain't feeling me here tonight. You took all my stuff. Don't play with me, man. Bring me all of my stuff, and I want it now. Watch what happens. Now the Bible says that they're on their way. They're on their way to get the stuff. Interesting enough that nowhere in the text do you ever see that God says to them, you need to go down Louisa Street or whatever that was. Turn right at the next corner. Nowhere. All right. But they are simply walking by faith. A whole lot of us would have a whole lot more than what we have right now if we would simply walk by faith. Look at what the text says. But while they are, I love this. While they are on their way to their stuff, don't know where they're going. All of a sudden, they run into an Egyptian in the field. He's been out there 3 days. He's about to die. And the text says that David and his men gave him some food, nursed him so we can get him a little strength. And this is what David said, hey, what you doing out here? Where you been? Why are you here? His response was, 3 days ago, my master left me out here. Where you coming from, though? Where were you before he left you here? Well, we invaded Ziglag. Oh, you talking about the stuff that we stole in Ziglag? Now, I really don't know whether some of y'all been following me or not, but he's really telling it on himself. Which gives a truth that if you give a monkey enough rope, he'll hang himself. David said, wait a minute, hold on. Will you? I need to tell somebody, you better be careful who you leave behind. Will you tell me where they are? He says, yes, but I got two requests. One, I don't want you to kill me. Two, I don't want you to hand me over to them and let them kill me. David said, look, bro, you don't have to worry about them bothering with you. I got another agenda. This Egyptian shows them, or shows David, where the men were and the stuff. When they found the stuff and the men, they were having not making it up. They were having a party. The problem was not the party. But the problem was that they were having a party with the stuff that they stole from David. Now listen, let me tell y'all. Some of y'all ain't moved yet, but you ain't gonna let me sit up here and make me believe you don't know in the Big Easy what a party is. I can't hear nobody in this house. I'm talking about the showing up party, the one that you didn't start getting dressed until midnight, the one that you said the party doesn't start until, I ain't got but one somebody that's going to help me right here. I got another right. The party doesn't start until I get here. And the Bible says that David whipped all of the men except for 400 young men who got afraid, jumped on camels, and took off. And the text says that they recovered all. Now, they're on their way back home. You remember the beginning of chapter 30? When they get to chapter 30, on their way back home with all of the stuff. Before they get home, you know where they have to pass through? The Bezar Ravine. Guess who's waiting? The 200 men, I read it a few minutes ago. Y'all, where y'all been? The 200 men who were too exhausted to go any further. And the Bible says that they greeted them. Hey, what's up? What y'all? All right. Watch this. And those 200 men begin to look for their stuff. Help me, Lord Jesus. Took me a while to get here, but I'm on it now, y'all. Can you imagine? The text says, and I didn't make it up, Johnson, that the evil men and troublemakers among Pastor David's followers You mean to tell me that that preacher, that David had some troublemakers in his camp? You mean tell me that David, Pastor David, had some troublemakers in his camp? Well, I'll just say this, and I'll go on with it. Everybody that's in your crowd ain't in your corner. I think I'll say it one more time in another way. Everybody that pat you in the back, they ain't patting you just to say you did well. They patting you just so they can find a soft spot. I can't hear nobody in this house tonight. Everybody in your crowd is not in your corner. Everybody that smile in your face, that doesn't mean that they mean you well. Let me move on. As these 200 men began to look for their stuff, the troublemakers. Can you imagine the ones who went to fight? Look, they said, huh? What y'all doing? We looking for our stuff. Yo, what? Come on, talk to me. Yo, stuff. Yeah, you remember, dog. You remember us. You remember us, don't you, bruh? You know, we classmates. You know, we tighter than 10 toes in one sock. Bruh, you remember us, don't you? And these troublemakers say to David, hey, or say to these men, you can I talk like I want to? You ain't got no stuff. Okay, you ain't want me to talk. You don't have any stuff. Since you did not go fight with us, you can't share in any of the stuff. Let me quickly get out your way. Thank God that somebody in the camp has enough sense to know that you can't do God's stuff like that. David turns around and says, no, 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 brothers. We cannot do that. the Lord has given unto us. And David was simply suggesting to them, brothers, first of all, the Lord, whatever we have, the Lord provided this stuff for us. And I need to tell somebody, whatever you have, it's not because you're so smart. It's not because you're so pretty, so handsome. It's not because you in fact got to have a good job. No, no, whatever you have, God gave it to you. And if you ask some folk how did they get to where they are, they'll start talking about, I worked my fingers to the bones and I did this and I did that. But if you ask some of us who've been born again, who know the Lord, we'll say, listen, I really don't know other than the fact that God gave it to me. Whatever I have, God gave it to me. As a matter of fact, I may run out of finances, but if I have the favor of God resting on my life, my money can get funny, but I can still get what I want, go where I want, because God's favor is resting on me.
Wait a minute. Not only that, wait a minute. Has God provided this stuff for us, but God has protected us. In chapter 29, man, we went to go fight and didn't even have to fight. We fought in chapter 30, and guess what? Not one casualty on our end, and we recovered everything. We could have been killed in battle, but the Lord left us here. I think I'm talking to at least 100 people who could have been dead a long time ago. But just like the old folk, the Lord kept you from dangers seen as well as unseen. Should have been you killed in that accident, but the Lord kept you. Could have been you killed in that car accident, but I'll say it again, the Lord kept you. Could have been you diagnosed with that dreadful disease, but the Lord kept you.
David was simply saying, since we are blessed, we can't treat them like they have treated us. And I don't know who I'm talking to in here tonight, but everybody in the world knows that boy is his. Look just like him. He can lie about the other one, but he can't lie about that one. That boy there, y'all ain't feeling me in here tonight. That one is his. But now, since y'all ain't together no more, he has put your name all out on the highways and the byways. Now, at that time, you were the best thing since sliced cheese, but now you ain't no good and you ain't nothing. He talking about you degrading you, and it won't pay child support. But guess what? Now the shoe is on the other on the other foot. Now the script has been flipped. Now you have the opportunity to help him. And I just want to know, do you have enough God in you to sit up and say, since I'm blessed now, I'm not going to treat him like he treated me? I have the ability to turn things around for you. It's in my hands now. But can I think about God's will enough to say, I am blessed? Not because of you, but because of God. And can I say that I'm not going to treat you like you treated me? Let me go another route with you. Sometimes our problem is that we allow people to hold us hostage for something in the past.
Several years ago, they were doing a study and they wanted to use monkeys to study monkeys, and they fixed up a little trap. Caught in the top of the trap, kind of looked like maybe the top of that water bottle, larger at the bottom, small at the top. They put something enticing on the inside of the trap. Maybe, you know, since it was monkeys, maybe it was a banana. And they put it on the inside of this trap. And when the monkey would stick his hand on the inside of the trap, he'd reach and he'd grab the banana. And whenever he began to pull to go forward, he couldn't get it out. He was trapped. But the only thing that the monkey could have done or should have done was release it and let it go. And I don't know who I'm talking to in here tonight, but you can't go get what God has in store for you if you keep holding on to other stuff in the back. I need to tell you something that's gonna let you live a little while longer. Let it go. Okay. The problem is, we've been carrying a grudge so long until no longer are we carrying the grudge. Now the grudge is harrying us. And so I'll just say it loud one more time. It'll save you a whole lot of headache and heartache. Let it go. She did you wrong. She did you bad. Yeah, you could get her back, but let it go. He deserves everything you give him and everything that you say to him, but let it go. Okay. All right. I got one more and I'm gone. I didn't read it a few minutes ago. But when David was on his way back home, notice David started going into places that never was mentioned in the text. And look what he's doing. Just giving out stuff. Yeah, just giving it away. Just start giving out stuff. Now, wait a minute. I thought at the beginning of chapter 30, and everything was gone. All David's stuff was gone. But the text says, Doc, that he recovered all. Now, wait a minute. He recovered so much that now he's able to give some away, which suggests to me that not only did the Lord provide for them and protect them, but the Lord will give you plenty if you give to folk that did you wrong. It suggests to me that not only did David get all of his stuff, but he got also the stuff that was his enemy. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. God will give it all back to you, plus some more. Let me see if I can get. I've been watching 2 or 3 of y'all. Let me go another route. Sometimes your blessing may be predicated
on how you respond to people who've done you wrong. I'm going to get happy all by myself in here tonight. You see, forgiving somebody, listen to me, is not my problem. That ain't my problem. Can I tell you what my problem is? Treating them like they have been forgiven. I guess I'm going to have to get happy all by myself one more time. All right, watch this. Watch this. Okay, I quit. Johnson, David simply says, look, y'all, we have access now to more than we ever had. Watch this. All because somebody was left behind. The Egyptian was left to die. Y'all, you see him, don't you? Left to die. All because he was left behind, we have access now to more than we've ever had. Somebody else was left behind. You see him, don't you? Yonder he is, between two thieves. Yonder he is, you see him, don't you? Thief on the right and a thief on the left. He was left behind. He was left behind because he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And brothers and sisters, we've got access now all because of Jesus hanging on the cross, dying and getting up that third day morning with all power in his hand. I've got access now to more than I have ever imagined. I've got access now to sit down at a table with the 4 and 20 elders. Feast on milk and honey. I've got access now to get close to a tree where the leaves, y'all ain't feeling me in this house, are good for the healing of the whole nation. I've got access now to speak not that are paid, but that are made with God. I've got access now to eternal life with him. But what I've got to get in my mind is that I cannot treat people like they treated me. Y'all know y'all was wrong. But I got enough God on the inside of me that will help me hold my tongue, help me hold my hand, that will make me treat you better than what you treated me. So since I'm blessed, I won't treat you like you treated me. Thank you.
You stand with us at this time. We're going to give you an opportunity to have access. You may come as a candidate for baptism. You may come with Christian experience. Whatever way you may come this night, you may come to receive access to the throne of God. And when you have access, the preacher told you all about it, what you would have when you have access. Do we see one who will come? It's ours to offer you. It's yours to receive. Do we see one who will come? After all of that preaching, there may be someone in the audience who will come. First, let God's favor rest upon you tonight. Let his favor rest upon you. If you're on the outside of the ark of safety, you haven't made peace with God. His arms are stretched open. Will you come tonight and receive his favor? If you want him to show up in your life, just step out on faith. Step out on faith. He'll show up. We have some witnesses in here. He'll show up. Why don't you try God tonight? Walk out on faith. Take one of these brothers by the hand. I on each side walk up the aisle with her. You need a line of communication where you come tonight. Saints are praying right now for you. You're not by yourself. I would walk out tonight. The only time you have is right now. This is the only time you have. Drive-by shooting are happening all around us. You don't know if you'll make it home tonight. You can't wait for Sunday morning. I would come tonight. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. He's speaking to you. He used the preacher to speak to you. He's using my voice to call you to a better life. You got to let go of some of that stuff. Let go of the world. Let go of friends. Because you will stand in the judgment for yourself. Do we see one who will come? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Blessed tonight. I've truly been helped. I thank God tonight for one Reginald G. Reid. Come on, give it up. God used this meticulous vessel to really teach you how to be blessed. Many of us miss it. You're looking at a vessel that enemy has almost destroyed. I was in such a bad shape that if you would mention church, a church folk, I would use obscene language. And I didn't get wounded in the street. I got wounded in the Lord's house. Watching folk, Wally, misuse my poor daddy. Pastor in three churches. And if he hadn't had a job, we'd have starved to death. What you say? And I watched them abuse him, misuse him. And he kept on preaching. Kept on picking them up, riding in his car. Kept on sending, make me carry stuff to him. Milk, eggs, such, et cetera. Until I had the audacity. And went to school a little bit, got a few degrees. Thought I knew something. I said, man, you got to be the biggest fool in the world. No folk don't like you. He said, son, you'll learn after a while. I'm in the Lord's house. And thank God I lived long enough to go to my dad and apologize. And a few days ago, he celebrated his 99th year birthday. Still has his right mind. Can't move as he once moved. And I asked him one time, I said, Daddy, how in the world did you take care of us of $5 a week? I never went to bed hungry. Went to school in 1945. I had more than one pair of shoes. I had pants to wrestle every day. And he told me two things. He said, the Lord and your mama. I'm trying to help somebody here. My mama used to tell him, you let folk, you know. That's all right. You want to be blessed. And watch this. He has never had to beg or borrow. He built a house, preachers, and didn't have a mortgage. When they put the last brick, P-A-I-D. In full. Folk riding around talking about, I ain't getting no preacher no money, helping pay for no house. I ain't getting no. So he had to say, wait a minute. Let me tell you something. See when they put the last brick on that house? It was paid for. You have to give me a dime. I'm still going to eat. I'm still going to live. I'm still going to ride in what I want to ride in. I'm still going to dress. My wife's still going to look good. That's why I share with young preachers, take care of your family. You'll always be blessed. Don't worry about them fellas talking about you henpecked. It's all right to be henpecked if the right hen doing the pecking. I'm just telling you. That's why I've been through the storm and the rain. I read you preach that for me. Brought you all the way from Texas, Canada to bless me. And I know somebody else got blessed beside me. Somebody else been hating so long you done forgot why you're hating. Turn it loose. Loose it and let it go. And praise the Lord. Thank you tonight. I didn't mean to go that far. More my wife looking at me strange, you know. These people got to go. Good to see you, Miles. I love people and I love preachers especially. And you say, well, you ain't never had no preacher. Yeah. I ain't been preaching 40 years and everybody treating me right. I done had some preachers do me some stuff. Yes, Lord, but I blessed them. I'm so happy tonight, and I just love God, and I love the men of God. Pastor Moderator, please don't sit down. I need you to come up here tonight. He don't like me to do this, but he's my past moderator, and he come all the way, you know, he busy as he can be, but you gotta follow somebody. Somebody gonna follow you one day. You got to be careful how you treat folk. I love this man here. See this man here? I love this man. Come on, Doc. Say something, bro. See these fellas here. Come on. You got to say something, bro.
Good evening. In all sincerity, thank God for our moderator. Come on, come on. I see one man standing, but somebody else ought to be standing as well. That's right. The Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due. Amen. I respect this man. I love this man. And as you take your seat, even so, I had to preach somewhere else tonight, but I would not go home without showing my face because of the respect I have for this man. Amen? Amen. Amen. God bless you, sir. Love you, man.
All right. We're almost ready to go. Will all of our pastors and preachers stand wherever you are? All of our pastors and preachers, would you stand?